All right, so welcome to ABV.
Yeah.
You might be wondering, where's Tommy? This is
Who?
A different Tom. But Paul's here. So Tommy's on vacation right now, so he wasn't able to make it. So I hijacked the show on my own. Don't tell him. As always, we have Paul Segura here.
What's up?
And today, we've got some special guests with us. We have Culture. We have the head brewer, Alex, along with her brewer, Addison.
Yeah.
And then you might recognize Tom from What's on Draft. He's come on the show a couple times to talk about his awesome show and the sexy brewer's calendar, of course, which I don't know. Wait a second. Oh my gosh. We have a celebrity in the house right now, the cover girl of the sexy brewer's calendar. So guys, welcome
to... That's me naked.
Yes! Yeah. Covered in hops. Who doesn't want to be covered in hops? Mm-hmm. So welcome to ABV, guys. Thanks for making time for us.
Yeah.
So we're going to start out with your La Cerveza. What can you tell me about this?
So it's our Mexican lager that we've been brewing for a little over a year now, and it's just, you know, in my opinion, a better crafty version of Pacifico. It's the beer that, like, if I am to have a pint while, you know, brewing and it's something light, we go with La Cerveza. It's all Pilsner base malt and a bunch of flaked corn and the Mexican lager yeast from White Labs. And it's, you know, really simple,
delicious.
But yeah, it's a very clean beer and...
It's refreshing, perfect beach beer.
Oh, for sure. Like, and we, these crowlers right here, we have a crowler machine at both tasting rooms. So like our, the brewery is right down the street from the beach. So if you fill up a crowler with La Cerveza, boom, you're done.
It's got a little bit of notes of Liberty Call spiced rum in there. Cause we,
right.
I don't know how that happened.
Why did that stuff mysteriously get into my glass?
Yeah.
But, you know, we're so close to Mexico. Like, it would be rude not to make a Mexican lager.
A proper Mexican lager.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is actually one of my favorite beers that you guys do. And it's a good, like, lawnmower beer, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
And since
lawnmower beer, he's using one of Tommy's terms.
I know.
See, he is Tommy.
Is that a thing?
It is,
funny.
You can go mow the lawn after this.
Exactly. It's funny because, so this is a fake brewery. That I should probably explain what this is. But my character's name within the What's on Draft series at this fictional brewery is named Tommy. So there is sort of a Tommy here in spirit. And I just used one of his terms, apparently. So
see, you're Tommy, we're thinking of you.
I'm channeling Tommy.
So what's the ABV on this?
This guy is 4.7.
Oh, wow. So you can definitely throw back a lot of these.
Yeah,
you
mean...
You can crush these.
Can.
Like
crush
Tom
these.
Said, lawnmower beer with, crushable. You know, shirt off, cutting grass.
Who has lawns
Real
in San
sexy.
Diego?
Yeah. It's illegal to have a lawn
because
of the drought.
I do.
Well,
it gives me an excuse to crush beers like this.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Right.
That's true.
So you guys brewed this at the Solana Beach location?
Yes.
Cool.
Mm-hmm.
And you have two locations?
Yeah, so we brew out of Solana Beach, and we also have a tasting room attached. And then the other tasting room is in Ocean Beach. And then our third tasting room is opening up in Encinitas, June.
All right.
So taking over the coast then.
Yeah, we're right on the PCH, so like just downtown Encinitas, you know. But it was definitely...
There's a lot of
red tape.
It
was a battle trying to get that spot, just because, I don't know. I don't live in North County, so I don't really understand, like... what the big deal is about just adding more beer to the scene, but they're like, absolutely not. There's going to be more like drunk drivers, people puking in the streets, and it's craft beer.
Isn't there never seen a brewery before?
Yeah,
you have to convince the city that it's not going to be like a dive bar where people are going to be getting wasted. And so, but I was actually at the city meeting with you guys when
the
Encinitas like officially approved that they could have it. And
was there a big like cheer celebration when it came through?
A bunch of people came through just to support Culture for it. It was really awesome.
That's awesome. Yeah. Well, cheers, guys.
There were a couple people.
So they took a look at you and they said, oh yeah, these guys are legit.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I showed them the calendar and that's what changed their mind about it. They're like, okay, all right. It's for the kids.
These guys are meant to be here.
Yeah.
Well, your beers are legit, that's for sure.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
I want like a million tacos with this.
This has a nice hoppiness in the finish. Yeah, I could see totally with fish tacos on this.
Mm-hmm. It's a little more bitter than, you know, typical Mexican lagers, but it's craft.
Right.
Like that's what you know, you say is like, oh, it's hoppy, it's craft beer.
But, well, I think when people think craft Mexican lager, they would expect something like this, right? This is like a fastball right down the middle.
Yeah, I mean, when this beer isn't on tap, it's just, you know, constant, like, not
where
complaints, but just always, like, where is it? I'm like, well... you know, for a small craft brewery to do lagers, it's a bit more difficult because the amount of time it takes up in a fermenter, and we only have 7 currently, so like that'll be one fermenter dedicated to a lager.
Yeah.
For, you know, a couple months. So therefore we can't brew the other beers.
It's also a good gateway beer. People come in and they say, I want something light.
Yeah.
And you're like, I'm the perfect beer for you.
I was just going to say that. Yeah. Sometimes you get newbies coming in and they're with a larger party or something. You got to have something for them so they don't turn around and split.
Yeah.
You give them that first one free, you get them in the door, and then you get them on the hook with the IPAs and the sours,
right, yeah.
And then they're hooked.
Right. Yeah.
And then you got them for life.
Mm. So we also brew a blonde ale. So we usually, that's like, we have that year round, so we usually offer them that. But when we have La Cerveza, like,
yeah. So specifically a summer beer comes out during the summertime, you don't have it all year then?
Well, we've had it on for the past few months just because of the demand for it, but typically it is more of a summer beer. But like I said, just because of how popular it's been, we're like trying to make space for it. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, right now we have 7 fermenters, but in a couple months we're getting 2 more, 20 barrels. So we'll have more space. But that's also because we'll be supplying Encinitas. Mm-hmm. And it's just me and Addison brewing. So it's like going to be constant brewing. Yeah.
So there's definitely a labor of love put into every single beer that's drank at Culture then.
Yeah.
Yes. And I mean, you talk to any like craft brewer and me, Addison and I, we brewed 4 times last week, and this time we'll be brewing 3 times, and for a small brewery, that's quite a lot.
Yeah.
Normally
that's what
it's like
you
2 or 3.
Though. I mean, you know, you gotta sort of, I don't know, make use of all that equipment and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, that's the cool thing about Culture, too, is like their beer, I think, is really well received, and because they have 2 tasting rooms, soon to be 3, but they don't really have any accounts. So like just those 2 tasting rooms, they can barely keep it on tap. Like people are drinking it.
Yeah.
People are going in there and
beer's already sold before you make it.
Yeah, which is a good problem to have.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, actually, we don't have any accounts. Like we used to have a few, but I mean, we don't have any accounts in the sense that like it's a reoccurring
right.
like
it's
sale.
It's all just for the tasting.
But
for,
like, you know, say
occasions.
Like if it's like a special occasion like Brewbies or you know if like say like Tornado hits us up or Hamilton's, they're like, hey, you know, we want a gluten reduced beer. Can we snag one of yours? Well, yeah, sure.
Is that something that you specialize in, gluten-reduced beers?
Yeah, so we can't say that they're gluten-free because the FDA and breweries, they haven't figured that out yet. Mm-hmm. To say it's gluten-free, it has to be brewed with gluten-free grains.
Okay.
And they have to check each batch, like, individually.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, which we do.
So we do test every single batch to make sure that the gluten is less than 20 parts per million, and that's just more for people with celiacs. People with celiac disease typically can't have more than 20 in a day.
Like our
20
roommate.
20 parts per million. Yeah. Yeah, our roommate. That's why he loves when I always bring home Culture.
Yeah, because there's just always Culture on tap at the house, like always. Yeah. That's what's on draft. It's Culture.
That's what's on draft.
It's usually Culture.
So like just for the test, is more for people with celiac disease. People who are just gluten intolerant, you know, it's either a preference, you know, like a personal choice to not have gluten or their body kind of rejects it, but if you have celiac disease, you can have like 2 or 3 of our beers and be safe. So we test every batch. So we are a gluten-reduced brewery because we add Clarity Firm, the enzyme, to do the gluten reduction. We add it to every batch, and we test every batch, but we can't say we're gluten-free because
barley is not gluten-free.
We're brewing with barley, wheat, rye, so
No, it'd open you up to some liability as well.
And we keep all the results behind the bar. So if anyone ever goes in, has a question to make sure the exact gluten content, we always keep those results on
hand. Yeah, because some people who are, you know, very intolerant, they can maybe only have like 10 parts per million, and certain beers of ours are
actually
less than 10.
Low.
So then we'll be like, oh yeah, this one's 7. Boom, you can have it.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm.
There you guys go. If you're looking for gluten-reduced beers, you know where to go.
Check them out.
Ooh, also, so, like Duckfoot.
Oh, Duckfoot is awesome.
Yeah.
Garage up in Temecula.
I think they, I don't know if they still do, but I know they used to. There's
Alpine
uses Clarity Firm. I don't know if they test all their batches, but they use it for the chill haze.
Amplified's doing it too.
Amplified.
Yeah.
It's becoming.
It's pretty cool.
I mean, more people are definitely
accessible.
Using it, but the thing is that like, every test is very expensive to do.
So my glass no longer smells like the rum we tasted earlier.
Yeah.
Right.
But while we're pouring these, do you want to speak to the rum real quick, or talk about
so
the rum?
So this is my spice rum that I make at Liberty Call Distilling Company out in Spring Valley, and just a local distillery. I actually did not bring this bottle today for this. I brought it and gave it to Alex because I owed her a bottle.
And she's so generous that she decided to share it with you.
She decided to donate it to
the
show. So
it's delicious.
That,
bless your heart. So are you guys also distilling beers there as well?
We make our whiskey, it starts off as a beer, the way we make our whiskey. So yeah, sometimes we'll take beer, distill it, and then obviously you gotta age it after that. So yeah, we have a 4-grain American whiskey and then an American single malt, which is actually kind of based on a red ale grain bill. It would have been a red ale, but then we distilled it and made it into whiskey.
Right on. So, yeah.
And the tasting room's open.
It's open
weekends, right?
Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Yeah.
Yeah, the hours are on our website.
Cool.
But it's open on the weekends, so you can come by and take a tour and taste a flight, taste everything we make.
And he does the labels.
I'm going to do that.
Addison makes these beautiful labels.
I got the job there just because I've been brewing beer forever, and I started making our whiskey mashes, and then I started to learn how to use a computer. So I started making our labels, and yeah, these are our new labels. We're rebranding this year, so.
That looks nicely done.
Yeah, awesome. Thanks.
Die cut and everything.
Tasty too. Yeah.
Addison was almost in the Sexy Brews calendar for Liberty Call.
What's the deal, man?
This is a little known secret about the Sexy Brews calendar. So we did this project for charity last year. When we got all of our friends to get naked. There's Derek from Duckfoot, or formerly of Duckfoot. And so we shot one with Addison at Liberty Call where he like got completely
naked
and like was just standing on the still, like holding it like as if it's a stripper pole, and then like holding, like hiding his junk from the camera. And it was a hilarious picture, but the data files from the camera got corrupted for some reason. And so we went back and we're like, hey, we need
STDs.
To.
STDs.
So we went back and we wanted to reshoot it because I was like, oh, this is so funny. But one of the other co-owners was like not stoked about it. He's like,
I didn't ask for permission. I was going to beg for forgiveness, and I did that, and I was forgiven. But then when he asked if we could do it again, I was like, I don't think it's going to work this time.
Definitely didn't have the green light.
Especially because the still is so much more fragile.
I was also burning myself standing on it.
I mean, that could have just, like, cracked in half.
Yeah, well, he was careful. But
there was an engineer there.
We are still recruiting brewers for next year's calendar, because we're going to do a 2018 calendar as well. So I don't know if you're...
Why you guys... I would make all the other guys feel inadequate. I'd better not.
I know.
Yeah,
I'm just saying, if you want to pull your junk out, it's for the kids.
Okay.
It's for charity.
Oh, no.
Did I phrase that wrong? Phrasing.
This is where we're going to segue. So what is this delicious in our glass? Smells tangerine-y.
It does smell tangerine-y and good.
This is the perfect beer for breakfast, actually.
I agree. So I just had a sip. It's not super tart. It's tart enough to be super refreshing, though, and it's nice and dry.
Ooh.
It's
got
might taste a little bit like a mimosa.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Well, there used to be a restaurant in Hillcrest called Our Gang Eatery, and they did mimosas, but they did it with Tang. So they did Tang mimosas, and that's what this is reminding me of.
Chicken
totally.
And glass.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Super good. Tang for adults.
Yeah.
I mean, that is exactly what we were going for, because we actually made this beer for our 4-year anniversary. That was about a month ago, and we had... How many beers? It was like 36.
37?
37 beers?
It's 35 or 37.
It was a madhouse.
Plus, there was like
too
a
much,
secret one.
Too much beers, yeah. But we made this beer for the anniversary, and it just, you know, we couldn't ignore it. It actually tastes like a mimosa.
Mm-hmm.
It has that like weird champagne quality because
totally.
It's the tartness.
Totally
from,
does.
Right?
Now, was this a kettle sour?
Yes.
Because I'm not getting any of that, like, you know, baby vomit sometimes stuff that's
no.
I love how you use that description,
well,
by the way.
Because a lot of kettle sours kind of have that, but this one's, like, super clean. I wasn't sure whether it was or not because I didn't get any of that stuff.
This kettle sour, I mean, it came out great, but during fermentation, obviously, yeah, it did have that, like, vomity, cheesy
it's not
essence
there now.
To it. But we let it, we really babied it in the fermenter. It sat in there for... almost 3 weeks.
Wow.
And we just kept purging it with CO2 to get that sulfur out of it. And I mean, it took up space for, you know, quite a long time, but I think the result was worth it just because it is a very, very clean Berliner. And
You also have to keep the oxygen off of it. So we even like climbed up on the roof and like covered up the steam stack to make sure like no oxygen gets into the kettle.
Everybody's got their own trick to do it. It's pretty hard to do to get them this clean. It's pretty hard to do. Hats off to you guys.
That, this beer, in a good way, gives me like cold sweats. I wake up in the middle of the night because I'm like, oh my god, is the pH too low?
And
I like
temperature.
And I live by the airport, and Solana Beach is, you know, like a 30-minute drive. So I'm like, I'm gonna drive right now to the brewery. And my boyfriend's like, no, it's fine, you're good. I'm like, just like itching to get in to check on it.
So as a head brewer, do you look at all your brews like kind of like as your children? And even if you're not there, you're constantly thinking like, what's going on? Like what?
Yeah, for sure. I mean. Even when you're not at work, you're working. Because you literally can't stop thinking about the beer, you know, just making sure, like, that you did everything to set it up. Maybe for the couple days that you're gone, but even when you are, you're like, I have to go check on it. Like, I have to go see if everything's good. And yeah, they're like my kids, our kids. I mean,
it's
I
like
get pissed
kid.
When something is like not right with it, and I want to, you know.
Leave a valve open, and you yell at me like I left a baby on top of the car.
So. Oh yeah, like if Addison's doing something with one of the fermenters, I treat the brewery like it's my home. Like I'm very anal about the brewery just because I've been working there for a while, and Addison's a newer addition. But we've known each other for quite some time, and yeah, he just laughs at me because like if he like. Spill something in the wrong spot, I'm like, you better clean that up right now because I feel like it's my house. And yeah, all the beers are my kids.
Well, so I have to ask you, how did you get into brewing? Because first of all, it's very, you don't see a lot of women brewers, let alone head brewers. So how did you get to where you are?
Well, I mean, it's not like the craziest story, but I was living in Chicago and I moved out here a little less than 3 years ago. But in Chicago, I was going to school for biochem, and that's what I had my bachelor's in. I have a biochemistry degree. But I was homebrewing just for fun because, like, I lived with four dudes in college. We're all super broke, and we're like, all right, we need beer. I'm thinking, I, you know, synthesize drugs on a daily basis, so I'm just going to start brewing beer. So I was a homebrewer just, you know, for, you know, shits and giggles. But when I moved out to San Diego, I was also bartending in Chicago, so I was just like, well, just, you know, get a job beer tending. And I got a job at Acoustic Ales, which is where I met these two guys.
Yeah.
Tom was already working at Acoustic when I got hired, and Addison got hired on like a week after me. And I remember that because when he came on, I was like, sweet, you're the new meat. Like, I'm not new anymore.
Yeah.
But yeah, I just, you know, I became a beer tender, and then I really wanted to brew, but there just wasn't any more space to brew for Acoustic. So I became a distiller instead, just by chance. The owner of Kill Devil, Ray, he met me and was like, oh, you have a chem degree? Sweet, we could use you. Started distilling, and then I saw a job offer for Culture. And cool. Like, it was very much chance, I think, especially with me, since I didn't grow up in San Diego. And I mean, you guys know, like, it really helps to know someone at this point in San Diego to become a brewer, because, you know, everyone and their mom wants to be
a brewer.
It's
super competitive.
Yeah. Right.
It was hard for...
Everything just kind of lined up very nicely for me, and I was the assistant brewer for quite some time with Mitchell Wicks, and he's in the calendar.
Yeah, he's Mr. April.
Yeah, he's Mr. April.
I was going to say, what do we have to look forward to next month?
But, you know, he actually moved to, not moved, he's traveling Australia for a year.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's him. Mm-hmm.
With his gold, that's him in all of his glory.
His gold medal around his weight,
yes,
his
culture
neck and nothing else.
Is like next month.
I do think objectively he's the best looking dude in the calendar, though.
Mm. Objectively.
Objectively. I think I can be objective because I'm in there too. I don't think I'm the best looking guy in the calendar.
He looks like he's got a great personality, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh, is that what you were looking at? Yeah, me too.
Eyes.
Yeah. But yeah, no, he was basically my mentor for a better part of the year, and he went to Australia, so I took up his mantle.
Well, you said chance. I think chance might get a person's foot in the door, but I think the rest was probably you. Because, you know, once that door is open, it's hard work and aptitude, you know, have a way of creating their own luck, I think. And I think you probably, I've tasted your beers now. I think you have both.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
They are delicious.
But I was pretty stoked, though, because then I wasn't, you know, it was bittersweet because Mitch left, and I love Mitch, so I was just bummed that he left. But then when I became the head brewer, I was able to not like choose the other brewer, but you know, the owners were really like understanding of the fact that it was just me and one other guy, and they were like, we want you to like send over a few people and then we'll interview them. And like I said, I met Addison when we were working at Acoustic, and he was actually my boyfriend's assistant, and then I stole him away.
Nice.
Yeah. So yeah.
Are you guys still together?
Yeah, we
that didn't break up the relationship?
Yeah. I definitely warned him ahead of time. Yeah.
Actually, when I got your message saying, like, hey, do you want to come brew for Culture? I was like, oh, I wonder if Aaron knows about this.
Yeah. Don't tell him.
That's actually how I met them, too, because I was brewing at Acoustic for about a year and a half. And then I'm actually really stoked that Addison ended up getting the job at Culture, because when I left Acoustic to do the show full time, I didn't spend as much time there, obviously. And so there was kind of less opportunity for me to have my friends be in the show and have them be a part of what's on draft. And so we shoot with Culture all the time because they, you know, they're very friendly to us. They let us do whatever we want. Like them, Burning Beard and Thorn are like kind of our three guys that we shoot with a lot. And so with them, with you guys both being at Culture, it's like I love being able to like shoot goofy stuff. Actually, the episode that comes out, or the What's on Draft episode that comes out today, they're both in it as employees of the fictional Sleepaway Brewing Company, where he's a brewer named Radisson, whose twin brother died in the boil kettle a year ago, and she's a salty bartender named Kylie. So.
Awesome.
Well, before we get into the third beer, what's going on with What's on Draft?
Well, What's on Draft, we're in the middle of season two right now. Like I said, today's episode, or the episode from the 27th, is another fictional account of this fake brewery, which we shoot a lot at Culture. And season one is on Amazon, so if you've got Amazon Prime, you can watch it on Amazon. Like I said, we're about halfway through season two. I got my brewing job at Acoustic because I wanted to make films about this, you know, important thing that's our local economy and our local culture, but I didn't feel that I would really have any ability to speak on it accurately if I didn't have a firsthand understanding of what it's like in the industry. And so I just brewed, kind of kept my head down and brewed and tried to learn all I could for about a year and a half. And now we're in full swing with the show and things are going pretty good. More viewers every day. And
that's awesome. I actually call him Radisson at work.
Yeah.
Just because, one, it sounds better. I mean, yeah. I think we can agree on that.
Actually, one time I started a tab and no one could find the tab. They're like, where's Addison's tab? And we found it at the end of the night. Clever bartender, thought he'd start under Radisson.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, let's wrap it up with our last beer. So this is award-winning?
Yes, it won a gold medal at GABF.
Yeah.
In 2016.
Yeah. Yeah.
Congratulations.
San Diego, right on.
So what is this?
It's just it's American brown ale. So I think the more popular style of brown to brew is English, typically just because English browns are a bit sweeter, kind of, you know, more caramel and less bitter. American browns have definitely that hop profile at the end. You know, not overwhelmingly, obviously. It's not a hoppy porter by any means. But it's got a bit more bite than a typical brown does and more malty, in my opinion.
It's got a really nice nuttiness and kind of a toastiness, if you will, too. And it's got, I think, just the right balance between residual sweetness and dryness.
Yeah.
It's really well-made beer.
It is.
This has always been one of our favorites at the house. We would always, when she would, coming home from work, she'd always text us, me and Jeff and Aaron, be like, what do you want me to bring home? We're always like, brown, bring the brown.
I can see this pairing well with a lot of different foods, too.
Yeah, it's really easy drinking. It's 5.8%, so, you know, you can either sip on it and really enjoy just the flavor, or, you know, just go to town, and no one will judge you, because it's not the heaviest thing.
Well, so we've got the two tasting rooms, the one in Ocean Beach and the one in Solana Beach, with Encinitas opening soon. And what's your website?
It's just culturebrewingco.com.
Easy enough. And before we sign off, I definitely need you to sign this. There's my pen. I need you to sign this, please.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yes. You're kind of famous.
Oh, the sexuals are real.
Yeah. The cover shoot was one of the most elaborate ones that
we need to sign over here.
I'm going. What did you think I was going to sign across my stomach?
Where was that picture taken?
So that's actually taken at the Solana Beach Brew House. So
really?
What she had to do was she had to pull the forklift into the brew house with the pallet on it. The photographer got on the pallet and we lifted the forks all the way up and then he shot through the slats of the pallet.
And there's a camera in there. So I had to have someone hold up a towel in front of the camera so I could actually get in my birthday suit. And
Because the owners can just log into the security camera whenever they want. She didn't want them to see it.
Right.
Completely naked, even though it mostly is in the final shot.
So you guys use whole leaf hops in that brewery, or those were brought in?
No, actually,
these are whole cone.
Well, yeah, they are, but I didn't use your hops. I didn't want to
No, we didn't put them in the boil after or anything.
That was the special
brew.
We're
not animals.
No, Eric from Starby had a bunch of Cascade that he was going to compost. Cool. And he's like, if you're willing to drive out here and get it, then you can have them. So we were able to get all those hops for free, and we raised $2,000 for Partners in Health with the calendar, which is great.
Oh, that's fantastic.
That's awesome.
Very cool. Yeah.
Cheers to that.
Literally saving lives by getting naked. So I'm just saying, next year's calendar, Paul, just think about it.
All right,
you don't have to answer right now.
I suppose you give me a couple beers, and I'm
in. That's the idea.
Actually, this day that we shot this photo, I worked a beer event later, and everyone was coming up to me, and they're like, you smell amazing. And I'm like, yeah, because I just spent about 30 minutes laying in hops, just like whole cone hops.
Awesome, guys. Well, thank you for coming on ABV. That will conclude this episode of it. Thank you, Tom, Addison, Alex. Got What's on Draft and Culture. And be sure to tune in next week when Tommy's here, and this will go much smoother.
I think it went pretty smooth as it was.
I think it went great. Cheers.
Cheers, guys. Cheers to beer.
Now let's drink this whole bottle now.
All right.
Okay, turn off the camera so we can drink that.